All right, everybody, welcome back. I feel guilty because I'm a fat, like I said in the opening statement, I'm part of the fast food culture. And I love it. No, I'm just, you know, I've got to tell you the truth. I love fast foods and I love good old delicious hamburgers. And you're going to give me a lesson here for my health, right?
You know that,
right? All right, and the gentleman who started it all, Assemblyman Tony Mendoza, 56th District, you authored AD 97. Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
In a minute or so, or 30 seconds or so, tell us about the bill. And then we're going to talk about it in length in a couple of seconds.
Well, AB 97 basically bans the use of trans fats in California restaurants by the year 2010. And I'm talking restaurants, cafeterias, any food preparation facilities will not be able to use oils that contain trans fats.
In 2011 for baked foods.
That is correct.
Right next to you have the woman who looked at me and I said, I love fast food. She looked at my tummy. She said, yes, right? I know it. I know it. Dr. Francine Coppin, thank you so much for being on the program.
Thank you.
You're with the Children's Hospital. In what capacity?
I am at Children's Hospital Los Angeles, and I'm a pediatric endocrinologist.
And you also authored a book entitled?
Diabesity, which is about the connection between obesity and diabetes.
And you're concerned about that. Let's just stay with you for a couple of seconds. So you're concerned that young children, as young as 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 years old, by the time they get to 10 or 12, they can have clogged arteries. Is that true?
Well, we start to see risk factors for cardiovascular disease. So young children developing high blood pressure and high cholesterol and type 2 diabetes. When I started my career 30 years ago, we did not have type 2 diabetes, what we used to call adult onset diabetes, happening in children. But now it is, and it's all linked to obesity. Obesity is from our lifestyle. And, you know, what we eat and what we do.
Well, if you ate, before I get to you, Assemblyman, if you ate things that you're not supposed to eat, but there was a lot of physical exercise, would you be as concerned?
No, I mean, there's some children who eat a lot because they're out there physically active all day. They're running marathons. They are athletes. And they can, you know, as long as they keep a good body weight, a right amount of waist circumference and adipose tissue or fat tissue inside the body, they don't have the same health risk. It's when you eat a lot and you're sedentary and you become overweight and obese, that's where the health risk develops.
And you see these little kids walking out of McDonald's or Arby's and they're just chubby. You just want to go pinch them. They look so cute. But that cuteness is what?
It's dangerous.
It's dangerous.
You know, I often see children at Children's Hospital Los Angeles who have a sweetened beverage in their baby bottle and their first food is french fries.
But how do you get away from, I'm going to get back to you in something in just a couple of seconds, but you go to the store and you see from wall to wall, starting with cornflakes, and then you see all these sugar cereals. I mean, what can a parent do about that?
Well, they can make the right choices. I mean, in that grocery store are a lot of appropriate choices. There's fruits and vegetables, there's low-fat dairy, there's appropriate kind of meats. You can make those choices and you can just tell your kids, we're not going to bring those other things home.
Hence the reason why you feel the state government had to get involved, first in the nation, to have this AB 97.
That's correct.
You gave us a real quick preview of it. Give us a lengthier view of what's taking place.
What took place here was very historic, and first of all. What prompted me to do this bill was basically I was a school teacher. I taught for 10 years in the
fourth grade, right?
Fourth grade. And I saw these kids, the obesity that was affecting our community, and the kids in general.
I mean, were they doing one of these numbers, trying to get in their desk?
Yeah,
a lot more than
their
desk?
You know, a lot more than that. It's not only the physical, but like the doctor just mentioned, you know, the inactivity. But when you talk to them and stuff, about what they eat, and basically they eat a lot of fast food. And when I knew that this compound, this ingredient was in our food supply, an ingredient that is unnecessary, easily, you know, replaced, and has really no nutritional value, why do we have it? And
Taste!
Actually, the people we have experts that would say that the taste is the same.
Really?
It doesn't change anything when you substitute it from one article to the other. So,
McDonald's did that, didn't they, or something? One of those companies did that, and
a lot of companies have done it already. A lot of restaurants take it upon themselves to switch over. But, you know, that's a fallacy. You know, for the last 20, 30 years, we've been using trans fats, and the people have tried to take on trans fats and eliminate them. They were ridiculed and laughed out of people's offices.
Well, somebody If that's the case, why did they use them if the taste wasn't there?
Well, at first, when they first initiated, the doctor knows about this more than anything I do. At first, when they initiated the trans fats, basically they wanted to get away from saturated fats. They thought that lard, having saturated fat, was a lot worse. And it turns out, spoon by spoon, side by side, you're much better off eating saturated fats than or lard than trans fats.
It's just back to the crazy. Doctor. What happened? How can we even screw up in 30 years?
Well, I think there's a lot.
Come on, you guys are brilliant. You can be. We pay $300,000, $400,000 to get you guys into medical school. You should come up with something that works. 30 years to figure it out, doctor.
Yeah, that's really the food industry who was looking for, less expensive ways to give us more calories. And I mean, if you really look historically, we needed to secure the food supply, and the food industry has done a great job of giving us enough calories so nobody's starving anymore. And now we have to kind of redefine what progress should be, and it's exactly what Assemblyman Mendoza is doing, which is now get that food supply and make it healthy again. So we don't need these trans fats. They do no good at all. They are atherosclerotic producing, so they're bad.
Whoa, you just whipped my brain right now, and I'm going to have to go to In-N-Out Burger to figure out what you just said. What did you just say?
They produce coronary artery disease.
Okay.
So you have a heart attack and a stroke, and earlier and more premature. And we're looking at risk factors in 5- and 6- and 8-year-old children that track throughout their lives. And a lot of this is related to our environment, our lifestyle, our choices, what's available for our families. And if you don't personally care, because nobody you know is affected, you're paying for this some way or another. In the health care expenditure bill, in the loss of the workforce, in what these kids are able to do and achieve. And we really have to come together as a nation. I laud this man for doing what he did.
Well, let's go from the health to the political. Why should the government get involved in our personal lives? If we want to get fat and die young, it's none of your business.
That's a good argument. People have said that for years, but you know what? It's not valid. The government is, one of the purposes of having government is to protect the health and well-being of the citizens. This ingredient has a direct link to obesity and heart disease, and thus we allow it in the food supply. Government steps in to ensure that not only our food supply is safe, that the paint is free of lead. You go above and beyond to make sure that the residents are not put at risk. And this ingredient has put our children at risk, as you can see every case study. And when I see these kids come to school and they're obese, that tells me something. We're not taking care of them.
Let's get a little deeper now.
Sure.
Let's talk about what happens to that child. Both of you, I want you guys to have a conversation here. When you're eating a lot of food and you're getting fat and you're eating all the wrong things, does that affect your study? Does that affect your homework? Does that affect your academic standing? Do you know?
I truly believe that. As a former school teacher, I don't want to say they're not smarter than the other kids, but you know what? They have kids sometimes can be mean, and they like to ridicule each other. And just some kids that are a little bit more overweight than others. They tend not to be focused on school so much and to more on their physical appearance or being ridiculed by friends or, it's just a way we're conditioned.
There's actually data showing that obese children view their quality of life equivalent to a child who's been diagnosed with cancer. We know that the rates of depression are very high in overweight and obese children.
Sure, if everybody's going to go to somebody's house to a swimming pool, or they're all going to get in a bus to go to the beach, the chances are some of these kids, not all of them, would not put on a swimsuit because they'll make every kind of excuse except for the excuse of saying, I'm fat. Mm-hmm. The reason why they're not doing it, right or wrong.
Well, for some children, absolutely, but it's not just the psychological. There's real medical reasons why some of these children don't feel well. They have sleep apnea, so they don't sleep well at night. They have a disturbed sleep pattern. They're tired all day long, and they don't perform well. They have more asthma. They have more, other physical conditions, orthopedic problems, skin problems, so that they have more medical reasons to underperform. And it becomes a lifelong kind of issue.
Now, were you poo-pooed when you brought this up to the legislature?
When I first introduced the bill on the floor, I had one of my Republican colleagues get up and said, what are we going to do next? Are we going to ban fat people? And it got a lot of response from different places of the aisle. But yeah, it was an uphill battle. It took a year and almost a year and a half to get it where to be signed into law, and it wasn't easy. We had a lot of opposition at first, and as we got more experts on board, said, look,